Thank you for coming this evening. My name is Jeff Betty. I'm the chair of the Tom Green County, and I have the honor of being your moderator this evening. Unfortunately, we don't have an attendee here this evening that we had hoped to have. For those of you that are new to the Republican or the legal side of the world, you may not have heard this name before. But if you're like me, if you go back, I have a degree in history, it was my thing, or as a lawyer, you're going to know this person. Justice Barbara Culver Clack was to the Texas Republican legal community especially an icon, a god, a goddess, I guess, and an incredibly important person for all of us. For those of you that don't know who she was the first Republican county judge in Midland County. She was one of the first Republican elected officials in the state of Texas, helped, was instrumental in creation of the Republican Party in Midland County, which is the core of Republicanism in Texas. She was a friend of my good friend Lou Brown, and that right there says something pretty good about her. She also happened to serve as a district judge and a Supreme Court justice in the state of Texas. And then after she was a Supreme Court justice for a while, she went back and went back to being a district judge again. One of the bright lights in our community, 91 years of age, unfortunately, she just passed away on us and was unable to attend. And I was very much looking forward to having her here and being able to show you that this is as impressive as these three are. There was a forerunner that did it in time when there just weren't that many women in the legal profession in the state, and did it, you know, in the face of the prejudice against Republicanism and women in law. And so I regret that she's not available to be here. Please, if you have any interest, look her up on Google and find her on the Texas Judiciary page. There's a wonderful write-up of her history. But mostly I would like to point out that she was honored by Texas Tech University as a distinguished alumnus. So on top of all of these other wonderful things, she was also a techie. Just saying. And I might have gone to the best institution in higher learning in this state, Tracy. So, having said that, and again, I try to lighten the mood up a little bit, but it's very unfortunate, but if you do have a moment, please read and learn. And I'm going to use this as an opportunity to segue to these three here, because I think you're going to find this interesting, that Justice Culver Clack worked at every level of the judiciary, and two of the three that are with us also started at various levels and made their way up. The other tried cases at every level, didn't you?
Yes.
So I'm going to introduce these ladies to you. I think you already know them, and I'm going to ask each of you, if you would, to just say a few words, and then we're going to get, I've got some question and answer for you. I'm going to put you through your paces a little, I hope, okay? So first, if I could, start on the far left. Justice Borland is Third Court of Appeals Justice. Justice Borland, would you be kind enough to say a word or two?
Sure. First, thanks so much for having us here. I love this, women in robes. I have to tell you that on the drive out here, I live in Round Rock, which is north of Austin. So it's a great drive out, and my brother called me and he said, "Where are you doing?" And I said, "I'm driving to San Angelo and I'm speaking on a panel of women judges." And he said, "Dear God, that sounds terrible." And then this morning, my best friend from fourth grade sends me a text, "You want to walk tonight?" I said, "No, I'm going to San Angelo." "What for?" "I'm speaking on a panel with women judges." And it was, .. So even though my own family wouldn't applaud for me, obviously, thank you. This is so validating that y'all speak and have interest in what we have to say. I serve on the Third Court of Appeals with Justice Goodwin. I was just appointed in January of 2015. There's six of us on the Third Court of Appeals in Austin, and with my appointment, all six are now Republican. So, and I haven't been a judge before. I was in private practice for 20 years doing business, trial, and appellate cases all over Texas, and that background has served me well, and I've learned so much, and you know, it's just a real honor. I'm a native Texan, grew up on a ranch, and I had an aunt and uncle that lived in San Angelo for 20 years, Don and Fran Hendricks. They had a They're both deceased now, sadly, and they moved back to the Austin area for family health reasons. But I spent a lot of time out here at high school and college driving out here to visit them. So it's fun and always love to come out here. Thanks for having me.
And the interesting thing we're going to talk about later is coming to the court, third court, from a practice side and coming to the court from the judge side, because Judge Goodwin can tell us all about every level of being a judge. So, Judge Goodwin, if you would.
Well, I'm Melissa Goodwin. I am also one of your judges on the Texas Third Court of Appeals, and I'm very glad to be here. One of the things that I am most excited to remind you of is that I was out here about 6 years ago asking for this job to be one of your justices on the Third Court of Appeals. And when I was doing so, I was asking, please send me there so that we can have a majority of Republicans on the Texas Third Court of Appeals. And if you do that, we can get more efficient, we can work hard and all that kind of good stuff. And lo and behold, 6 years ago, y'all were the tipping point. I know you've heard this, Republican women, you've heard me say this before, but it's very true. Y'all were the tipping point in my election. And when the Tom Green and Concho Valley votes came in, that's when I figured out that I had won the race. And that's kind of what started things rolling, which now gives us all six members on the Texas Third Court of Appeals as all Republicans. So thanks for starting that tide. I really appreciate it. I love my job. And here's the best thing about what you did for me 6 years ago, and for you as well. Y'all have been helping us win so handily that I'm on the ballot again. My first term is up, and I'm on the ballot in November, and I don't have an opponent. Neither does Judge Borland. So I think that y'all have proven a point with a big old exclamation point, so I thank you for that. I've served Texas in the judiciary as a JP. I've served as a district court judge, and if you want to talk about that later, we can do that too. And I started out my career on the Texas Court of Criminal Appeals as a lawyer there for 9 years, and I just got back from a celebration for the Texas Court of Criminal Appeals. They just celebrated their 125 years of existence, and that was it's been a very exciting day seeing people like Judge Onion, who is 91 years old, was a World War II veteran, and has served our country and our state so admirably. And so to get to start my day with Judge Onion and to end it here, it makes me so very happy. I'm glad to be here, and I look forward to the conversation.
I'm going to point out that I have not made any short jokes.
Not yet.
Yeah.
I wore my highest heels.
I noticed.
And
I will say that perhaps one of the greatest members of the judiciary ever, Judge Clack, was only 5 foot tall, so height.
Yay!
I think you've never been 5 foot in your life.
Yes.
And so, last but not least, obviously, is Justice Guzman. Justice Guzman not only has been on the 309th District Court, but also 14th Court of Appeals in the Houston area, and is now a Supreme Court Justice.
Thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me to be here today and for sharing your evening with us. I am Eva Guzman, and I am born in Chicago, got to Texas as soon as I could, and I grew up in Houston. My first job as a judge was in 1999, when then Governor Bush appointed me to a district court. And I was doing such a great job that Governor Perry appointed me to the Court of Appeals in 2001. And I served there for about 10 years. And I was appointed again and to the Supreme Court of Texas in 2009. There have been 8 women in the court's history to serve full time on the court. And Judge Culver Clack was the second woman to serve on the court. I had an opportunity to meet her over the years and to help honor her in Midland this year. She was an inspiration and a mentor, and thank you so much for recognizing her tonight, because she was a trailblazer. These women did pave a way for the rest of us. When she served, there were very few women in law, and much less in the judiciary. I had opponents all along the way. I don't want you to think that I just got appointed. I had to run, and I've had opponents, and I want to say thank you. When I ran in 1999, I didn't know anything about politics, and I'd never run for anything, and I just didn't know. But Republican women, they just reached out to me. They opened their arms, they embraced me, they taught me everything I know about politics. And if you ask anyone now, well, not even Guzman, she gets out there and she runs. So much so that with your help, I became, in March, the highest vote getter ever in a Republican or Democratic contested election. And I'll conclude with this. I also have the unique distinction of being the first Latina on the Supreme Court of Texas. And when you hear the media talk about Republicans and the relationship that we have with the Hispanic community, I'm here to tell you, Republicans elected the first woman to statewide office. Not Democrats, Republicans. You did.
It's funny you should say that. One of the things that just went around Facebook recently, and I think some of you may have seen that if you're my friends, and many of you are, is I'd like to remind you that when this country put an amendment to the Constitution saying that people will be treated the same regardless of race, creed, or color, it was Republicans that passed that and not Democrats. So don't forget your history, ladies and gentlemen. Speaking of history, as far as one of the things I want to talk about is this group is educated, they know the system, but there's things that we want to talk about. And one of the things I want to talk about with these three is my own personal life, of course, because that's what's most important to these folks. Seriously, I had an appeal recently from this court here in Tom Green County. I was doing a CPS matter, and the lady lost her kids. I was her attorney. And you know what happens in that case, don't you, Judge? You get appealed sometimes. And one of the grounds for appellate action like that is ineffective assistance of counsel, and no attorney ever wants to hear that phrase attached to their name. Now, I will proudly point out that this wonderful group of people on the Third Court of Appeals decided I was not ineffective. I was downright, I believe you said, competent, and I was even consistent with the standards. So I rose to the high level of competency and consistency. And I thank you for that great compliment. But no, my point is, could you explain to these folks, starting with Justice Borland, as a practitioner in the court system, where does the Third Court of Appeals fit in the judicial constellation, so to speak?
Sure. Well, I feel your pain. It's it has been eye-opening to cross over from practice to the bench. And I have learned so much about how Texas works serving on the Third Court of Appeals, because of course we sit in Travis County, so not only do we do civil, like family law matters, criminal, administrative law, anything that tangles with a state agency, all that complex stuff you read about in the papers comes right across our desks. The Third Court of Appeals, unlike Justice Guzman, and see, this is in reverse order. I think this is a little bit like hazing. The senior justice on the Supreme Court should be going first and leave the front. Just coming to this, you know, and speaking now to a lot of these groups, I prepared a kind of a visual aid that helps people see how it fits in. And let me get that. And if Vanna White could kindly carry this around.
Oh, I wish. Have y'all seen Vanna Lynn? My goodness, she's well preserved. This is not well preserved, as you can see. Sorry to blind those of you.
Now, I can just stand up here quickly, but this will give you a walk around with it, but sometimes I'm hesitant to use this when I'm speaking on a panel with either a Texas Supreme Court justice or a judge on the Texas Criminal Court of Appeals because it makes the third court look like we're the center of the universe. In no way does this mean to imply that these two high courts are not more important than we are.
If I could step in for just a second. This lady worked as an attorney for this court for many years and has many friends. This lady is on this one. So Justice Borland doesn't mean to suggest that her court's more important than the work of these two ladies. Right, Justice?
That's it, correct.
All right, I got it.
But to, as we go around to kind of give people a visual of what this means, each of the 14 intermediate state courts of appeals, they're numbered 1 through 14, just kind of in the order that they came into existence. We're the third. The third court of appeals, our jurisdiction is over 24 counties. That's 24 Texas counties. I was talking to Senator Perry. I feel better now. His district is way bigger. But getting on the court, this is a big area. So day to day in all of these counties, like Tom Green, the trial judges are out, you know, the wheel of justice is turning, trying cases, things are happening, divorces are happening, criminal defendants are being convicted or acquitted. And if any of those parties and their counsel in any of those 24 counties think there was an error of law, an error made by the trial judge, they appeal to the Third Court of Appeals. And that's why we're sort of the last generalists. We're not specialized like I was in private practice doing business litigation. We do everything. We do criminal, civil, and administrative appeals. Administrative, as I said, like public utility commission cases, water rate cases. Anything that makes you think you need a third cup of coffee, that's what an administrative appeal is. And then we do not have discretionary jurisdiction, so we must take every appeal that comes to us. So that's why we are a high volume court. The two higher courts, Texas is among a handful of states that bifurcates at the top. So at the top, we're split civil and criminal. And Justice Guzman sits on the Texas Supreme Court, the highest civil court in Texas. There are 9 justices up here, 9 over here for criminal, and then 6 down here at the Third Court of Appeals. Because the highest courts sit in a group of all of their justices, and because of just the volume, they sit over every one, not just the third court, but all 14. They have discretionary jurisdiction, and I'm sure Justice Guzman will speak to that, but they take a small percentage of the cases that are of great importance to the jurisprudence in Texas. So that means, because they don't take every case, for most what I would call, most of the appeals, we are the last voice in these 24 counties. And so that puts a greater importance on what we do to get it right and, you know, just to keep our docket from getting backlogged and all of that. I mean, it's all of these, this little schema represents a lot of what I would call, reality TV. It's real. Lots of lives, parties, anyone that's ever been through that system gets that. And I'm because I am so fresh from private practice, I'm very attuned to the need to get our cases pushed through. So
thank you, Justice. And I think that what I'd like is I'm going to move on to Justice Goodwin here, because I thought there might be an interesting connection here. You come from a judicial background. You served as a justice of the peace, and God help you, a district judge in Travis County, 427th district, and now in the Third Court of Appeals. So if you could speak both from a judge's perspective, what you think is important that comes before you, but also how that relates to how you work with judges at the other levels.
Okay, so as a JP, I think that's where most of Texas gets their opinion and their impressions of the judiciary. And because I served as a JP and I started teaching classes to justices of the peace throughout the state of Texas, I've continued to help train JPs in Texas. And And they are really what most of the public thinks of when they think of the judiciary. And so they bring a different perspective than what we might do. A JP in most communities is going to hear probably, you know, 15, I would hear about 30,000 cases a year as a JP, as opposed to when I was a district court judge with felony jurisdiction, I would hear maybe 100 cases a day. But now on the third... And now on the third Court of Appeals, the volume is very different. I don't know if this is what you were getting to, but on the third Court of Appeals... My youngest just went off to Pittsburgh, so I finally have all three of my kids in college, and Pittsburgh is a very long way away, and so I have a hard time leaving my phone, and she's texting me about Parents Weekend, and so I had it in my hands, and I didn't mean to bring it up here, but my apologies, and that's probably her texting from Pittsburgh. But I don't mean Pittsburgh, Texas. I mean Pittsburgh. So my apologies. But anyways, to give you a little bit of a difference in what we do, on the third Court of Appeals, we will probably write about 100, I think I wrote up just over 150 decisions, opinions, as a judge on the Texas Third Court of Appeals. So that kind of gives you the scale of what we do. A JP may hear 30,000 cases a year, a district court judge may hear 150 cases a day, depending on their day, and we write about 150 written opinions throughout the course of a year. So it's a very different scale. So I don't know if that's what you're getting at, but that's...
That's part of it, but also we know it because we breathe it, but when you're a JP and you make a decision, you know that you could be appealed. How does that affect things? How's the communication work, I suppose?
I can tell you that was one of the happiest things about being a JP is that you know that every case can be appealed, and every case that is appealed is an appeal de novo, which means everybody gets to start over and not worry about it. And so you really it's quite liberating once you get used to it. With us, we write our decisions in 10 to 20 page opinions, some of them very much longer. And then we know that these smart people over on the Supreme Court are going to be grading our papers pretty closely. So again, my apologies, it's her chart, not mine.
So moving on. So now, Justice Guzman, we've heard that the JPs are free, but the district judges know that their papers are being graded, and now you're grading the Third Court of Appeals papers, but some of the papers you're grading from the Third Court of Appeals are from regulatory agencies. Civil matters involving TCEQ, the beloved TCEQ in the state of Texas, property rights. How do you grade? What is the basis? What are the appellate matters that come before the court? We know they appeal. But what are you trying to tell the state when you make a decision?
The court is a court, as you heard, of discretionary review, and that means that we set our own docket. And the way that process works, there are about 1,100 petitions, requests for the court to review a matter filed a year. We grant about 11% of those cases on average. And the way that works, I vote every Thursday at noon. Someone has a complaint about what these justices did. It comes in the form of a 4,500 word petition. Every justice reads that independently. We all vote electronically now, and so I cast my vote. I either want to discuss it, get a response from the other side, or deny it. If one out of the nine judges decides to do anything other than deny, it comes before the entire nine-member court, and we discuss it. We debate the legal issues presented in the petition. What do we look for? Well, Texas Rule of Appellate Procedure 59 requires that they invoke our jurisdiction. How do they do that? Let's say the Third Court of Appeals decides a case one way, but Houston goes another way, and Corpus Christi goes another way. Now there's a conflict among the courts of appeals. If you've got business in all three cities, you have no idea how to assess and evaluate risk, how much to charge for your products, etc., because you don't know where your case is going to land. We are likely to consider that case. Sometimes, one of the judges on a three-judge panel will disagree. Two will write one way, and one judge says they got it all wrong. That's another instance in which the court takes great interest. The other types of cases that come before the court, statutory interpretation. Senator Perry, y'all passed legislation. And, you know, they write a statute, and we look for the plain meaning. What they wrote is what they meant. But it plays out differently all over the state. So people go to the trial court, they don't like what they got there, then they go to the Court of Appeals, they don't like that either, and they come to us. And a lot of our work is statutory interpretation. We interpret the legislation that is passed. The other issue that we look for, what's important to the jurisprudence of the states? We can't correct every error, which is why their work is so important. I spent 10 years on an intermediate court. I understand how important, and most of our citizens, it's true, that's where the decisions are made. But we look for cases that are important to the jurisprudence, and everything we do, if you're curious, is on our website. You can go to txcourts.gov, go to the Supreme Court, you'll see me in oral argument.
It's exciting stuff.
I don't know about that. We get those regular appeals. But I will tell one story. At the Court of Appeals, arguments are not videotaped. At the Supreme Court, they're videotaped. And so when I got to the court, there was a case involving police officers arguing. Of course, I'm married to a police officer, and the lawyer made some sort of argument, and I said, no, wait a minute. I've been married to an officer for 30 years, and that just isn't right. And then I said, wait, no, it just feels like 30. It's not 30. Well, it was on camera now. So I had to go explain to my husband why I said that.
Okay. So one thing that before we ask anyone else if they'd like to ask a question, and we're not quite there yet, but just the one thing I want to get all of you to comment on is, as a candidate for office, I ran for office this last spring and had an opponent, and I'm an attorney. Carmen, it's fun, isn't it? And when you're an attorney, you're not only under the rules, the regular rules of honesty and privacy and all those sorts of things, but you're under the rules that attorneys, disciplinary rules that all attorneys operate under. But y'all are under more than just, because all of you are attorneys, of course, but you're also under the judicial code and the commission that enforces it. So I'd like you to each speak to the challenges of campaigning, and if we could start, no offense, testimony. We start here and work our way back that way, because you're currently in an election and you're running. We've got them taken care of, but we need to work for you. But tell me the challenge of being a hard-nosed Republican candidate that can't say anything about most of the issues Republicans want to talk about.
Well, you know, it is a concern, but when it comes to judges, most people want the same thing. They want you to be fair, they want you to be independent, and if they're conservative, they want you to uphold the Constitution. Nothing else is that critical in judicial races. So when I get up and I speak to groups, I talk about those core values. Occasionally, someone is really angry about a decision. I went to somewhere up in y'all's neck of the woods, and I had a gentleman just start screaming at me, and my husband was sitting right over there, and he's learned. He just kind of sat there patiently, but I couldn't respond to his concerns. He was mad about a particular decision. We're not allowed to talk about the cases other than what's in the opinion. That's it. I can't tell you what I was thinking, what my colleagues were thinking. I can't even tell you how I feel personally.
But Judge, we want to know what you're going to rule on a case next year involving name, important issue.
That's
you can't answer
crime.
That question.
No, that's even a crime for me to tell you.
And I want to point that out, because lawyers can at least advocate a position. We're not prohibited from doing that. but judges are. So, Justice Goodwin, you've been through this. You actually had a primary opponent, that dastardly evil Scott Fields, who now sits next to you on the bench. We knew he was good, didn't we, folks? And next time we had a chance to vote for him, there we went and we got him. So, but when you've had primary situations, so here you are running a hard-fought race against who one of the best men in the judiciary in the state of Texas, in our opinion. You like him, he's your friend. You had a hard race fought. How do you run a race in a primary without accidentally saying how you're going to rule on something, which is against the rules, or commenting on something you've already done?
Well, when you have a record, you can let that stand for itself. And you have to live or die by it. And sometimes that's hard to do, because when you are, you take an oath in Texas, you take an oath to support the Constitution and the laws of the state. And you take that oath to enforce them as they are written, not as you might like them to be, not as you want them to be. So, you know, again, another nod to Senator Perry out there, you know, get them right, get them clear, make sure that we know what you mean. I have twin boys. If I ask, you know, what they mean, I'm going to have two answers going around in those two brains of theirs. I have no interest in trying to divine what is going on in the minds of the Texas legislature. Ever. So,
Nona, please stop texting your mom.
So that's one thing, is, you know, you let your record speak for yourself, for itself, but sometimes you have to write a decision that you might not personally like, but it is what the law is. And so that's the best you can do, is talk about that decision and that law that you have. In every other respect, you really are dependent upon the people that are around you. You talk about what you do, you talk about your feelings, you talk about what motivates you to be a judge or to be on the bench. But for those of us, and I know that these women are going to agree with me wholeheartedly, you depend on your friends and your family to really kind of carry that water for you. And one of the best and most effective tools that we have as members of the judiciary is the Texas Federation of Republican Women. Without reservation, I can say that. And I can say that because I'm a former president of a TFRW club. But, you know, I wrote down here our four purposes of TFRW: training and education. That means we try to train and educate the people around us, to educate ourselves on the roles and what people do and the decisions that they make, but we also try to train and educate our neighbors. One of our tasks is to, in fact, elect Republicans. I think that when you pick a side, Republican or Democrat, I think that that says something about what you think about your judicial philosophy, and I think that there's something that can be said for that. And we also, in TFRW, encourage women to run. And I didn't come by this because I said, hey, I want to be a judge someday. I was a TFRW member beforehand. I had some people that kind of mentored me, kind of kept me going in the political ring. We were working on other campaigns, and they said, hey, you know what? We like what you stand for. Why don't you get out here and run and be in office? That's one of the things that TFRW was about. Right, Lou? I mean, this is what we do. Louise Foster, some of the real old-timers will remember who she is. She's a former, well, did she do, Lou? And she's the reason I'm sitting here, is because of Jim and Louise Foster, because they said, hey, you're a great member of this club. We know what you're about. We need to get you in office. So in that respect, I love what y'all are doing here. I love that you're educating people about what the judiciary does. And I know that you're mentoring young women and men and encouraging them to run for office. And the other thing is the community service. So I value what you do. And y'all are the opinion leaders for your community, not me. I mean, when you're a judge, you can only raise money in certain limited chunks. You don't get to say a whole lot. You can run on your record, but that's about it. Nobody understands it. Nobody understands the law. We all do our best, but hoy vey. So you depend on your friends and your family, and you depend on the TFRW and organizations like that to carry the water for us. So for me, that's what I relied on.
I'm not going to make you follow that, Judge Borland, but I'm going to change topics for just a little bit. That was brilliant, of course, as she always is. But I'm going to talk for a second about you, Judge Goodwin, and then you are appointed to the Judicial Ethics Committee, the the Professional Ethics Committee of the State Bar of Texas and the Texas Judicial Council. And you teach JPs on ethics and proper conduct. But...
And in drafting the criminal pattern jury charges.
Oh yeah, that too. And that's easy though, that's...
That's easy stuff.
Yeah. But the reason I go there is because that's your area. Both of the ladies beside you have personal connections to law enforcement and those who work in law enforcement, work in law enforcement. Justice Borland, could you tell us about your connection to law enforcement?
Sure. Well, my late husband was a DPS officer when we met, and then I promptly put tremendous pressure on him to get a job that made more money and was safer. And he ultimately went into business. I was sharing with Senator Perry. It's funny, in those days, I was worried about him getting run over working out in the hinterlands where the troopers work. I wasn't worried about a drug cartel or the things I'd be worried about today. He ultimately passed away from cancer, not anything job related, but he was, so he did both. So that's my connection. My more colorful connection is, had a lot of background in my family with law enforcement. My grandfather was a captain of the Texas Rangers. So yeah, and he was a captain, kind of stationed and head of Camp Mabry in Austin in the late 40s when the Rangers had come under the jurisdiction of DPS. And there's some great old postcards that they used to sell like in Stuckey's in Texas of photos. You know, the Rangers were kind of out there a little bit. And when they came under DPS, I think they did a little PR work. So they sent a photographer up to the ranch I grew up on, which was my grandfather's ranch at the time, and had all these photos of like the Rangers watering their horses at the creek. And it's so we got all these great black and white photos, and I've got some of them on my campaign website. So it's fun. I enjoy that. And, you know, that background.
So we already heard that you were married to a member of law enforcement, but do you know how many years now? Not how many it feels. Seriously, how many years have you been married now?
So we did celebrate, finally, 4 or 5 years after I said it, our 30-year anniversary in France this summer.
Wonderful.
And so, he served 37 years with the Houston Police Department. Yeah.
Thank you. We talked about committees and commissions. You're also involved in a number of commissions and committees. I happen to know the one that kind of jumps out at me is you're involved with children, youth, and families, the Permanent Judicial Committee. Can you talk about that for a second?
Sure. So each Supreme Court judge has assignments outside of our day job, writing opinions and reading records and that sort of thing. I am the court's liaison to the Commission on Judicial Conduct, so I am particularly sensitive about that. I am also the chair of the court's Commission for Children, Youth, and Families. What we did in 2007 is brought stakeholders together. So you have about 30,000 children in foster care. They're not going home tonight like the rest of us. They are in sleeping in offices, just not enough space for them. Some of them are in some centers that really don't meet their needs, and some are fortunate, they're with foster families. So you had educators touching the lives of these children, doctors touching their lives, judges touching their lives, psychiatrists, all sorts of people. No one was communicating about anything. So in 2007, the court created the Commission for Children, Youth, and Families, and we said we are going to bring everyone around one table, and together we will debate, and together we will dialogue, and together we will find resources to change the outcomes for children in foster care. The court has had tremendous success as the facilitator. We bring everyone together. We had an education summit. We came up with 100 recommendations for how these children progress through the school system. You see what was happening, you're in foster care, they yank you overnight. You wind up in another city, the school doesn't know anything about you, your records don't transfer, and so the dropout rates are pretty high. We came up with an education plan. Did you know that the federal government pays you more money if your kids are in more beds, your foster children? So what was happening? You had kids in foster care that were on 10 medications. They got more money. So we went to the legislature. We need that law changed. So now There's a lot of accountability. So I'm very passionate about that. I'm also, and I'll stop here, but I'm also the liaison to the Access to Justice Commission. Someday, every Texan will have access to our courts, no matter how much money you make, to our civil courts. And so we're working on that as well.
And one reason I hit you on that question is, Karen, Carmen, we do that knowing. We do CPS, and we know what you're talking about. And you don't take on CPS cases lightly. You don't take them on because of the money, do you, Karen? Carmen. For those of you that don't know, the current hourly rate for an attorney working CPS cases in Tom Green County is $75, no expenses. You make a bit more than that in your private work, don't you, ladies?
It's God's work. Thank you for doing that.
It's okay. But I wanted you to know that when you see the newspapers talking the way it talks, there are good people who know the system that are working on it, and be careful of believing everything you read in the newspapers. There's great tragedies and great troubles, but we're working on it, and thank God, thank you for your work. So as far as, we're going to go to questions now, but I'm warning you, if you ask them what they're going to decide on a case, I'm going to step in and I'm going to throw my body in front of them and say no. There's one person I forgot to recognize earlier, a very important person, and he's been sitting very patiently. Max, could you raise your hand? This is one of the twins. Say hi. Thank you. Having two children that have sat through many exciting political event, I feel you, Max, and thank you for coming. We're glad to have you. So now, questions. Anyone have an interesting question? Not you, Martha.
Not interesting question.
Anybody have anything? Because I've been doing a lot of talking up here, and Tracy has not kibitzed once tonight. Tracy,
I'm on my best.
Congratulations. She's sick. She doesn't feel good. So anybody have anything? Fine. I will use this opportunity to continue talking. Now, as a local practitioner here now for 20-something years, I've done both business law and family law. I transitioned to, I know, exactly. That's the way it felt when I left the city of San Angelo and went into family law. And I've discovered that the amount of direction from the Third Court of Appeals differs greatly based on the field of law you're in. In the world of civil litigation, it's the book, the cases and the opinions. Could you tell me how it is that when a local lawyer is trying to figure out how to help their client, how do they do that? The mechanics. Don't give me that look. Pretend it makes sense. The mechanics. How are we getting our direction? What does the opinion do that gives us that direction? This is kind of where I'm at.
Well, I'm not sure that I'm going to get this, so maybe if you have some ideas, you know, chime in. But I think you're talking about the difference between how we issue some opinions versus others. We have things that are called traditional opinions, which end up in the books, and they are longer, they are more detailed, and they take more time and effort, versus a memorandum opinion that is necessarily shorter and more succinct, less law, almost no facts, and they're kind of dry and boring to read. So we do the two types of opinions for two different reasons, and it's kind of like we're trying to talk to the Court of Criminal Appeals or we're trying to talk to the Supreme Court. A memorandum opinion is something that the Texas Supreme Court said that we can do for your average case that doesn't lend itself to any huge areas of law. It's not important to the jurisprudence of the state. It doesn't involve millions of dollars, so do quick and easily and get out of there. We also use them, though, I think, for cases that involve CPS or cases that involve family issues so that we can leave some of the facts out rather than put them on the internet, because everything that we do, just like the Supreme Court, well, almost, every opinion that we write is available electronically and online, which means if we put in a bunch of all the gore and the salacious details, all of that's going to be preserved for just about forever for those families. So we try not to put that in there. So we try to keep those opinions a little bit shorter. The bigger opinions or the ones that affect the jurisprudence or make a change in the law or something like that, those we put in greater detail. But I think that's because everything's online.
when you ask an engineer what the solution to the problem is, he engineers you a solution. When you ask a plumber, he figures out the plumbing. And when you ask a carpenter, he uses a hammer. I asked a judge from the judiciary, and she explained the judicial meaning of opinions. Let's see if we can get a former practicing lawyer. When you've got a client that walks into your office and says to you, I want to sue this sucker, I want to get my money back, the mechanics of an attorney, what does the third court opinion do for that attorney?
Well, it...
Because these aren't lawyers, by the way. There's a couple in here. There's a few lawyers scattered around, but they're not lawyers, and they don't know what a lawyer does as far as that part of the job. So maybe if you could explain, what when you're writing an opinion, who's your audience?
We have many audiences, and that's been very eye-opening for me. Writing these appellate opinions are quite challenging. There's a tension in making it short. I'm a big proponent, whether it's a contract or a statute or a judicial opinion, plain language and to the point, so that people can understand it. And I had the pleasure of working with some really sophisticated folks throughout my practice, and I'm telling you, not a one of them could have read one of our opinions and rattled back to me exactly what it meant. So our audience, and the tension that's built into this, our audiences are the parties, right? First and foremost, on any given day, think about this. On any given day, I do my best job, 50% of the people are gonna be upset with me. So I've got to, and procedural fairness to Justice Guzman's point is key, because 50% are not going to like the outcome, but I've got to put enough description in there of the rules and why and the law supporting it. Procedural fairness, if you don't have that in the system of law, you get all this cynicism and rioting and everything, all this ugliness we're seeing, in my opinion. You've got to have procedural fairness that people understand. They've got to understand it. So you've got to have that in there. You've got to have a little bit of the facts. I also try to sanitize some of the opinions, these terrible child abuse opinions. I cry when I read these records. They're just terrible things that happen to children. And we write them in pseudonyms or initials. But it's State of Texas versus John Smith. And if John Smith was your uncle or your mom's boyfriend and you're reading this that's published to the web, all these horrible things that happen. So we've got to have enough facts in there so that the parties understand it. The public at large, these are published opinions. And then finally, to the folks that are grading our papers, like Justice Guzman, they've got to be able to read the opinion and see why we reached that conclusion, to see if they agree or if they think we've made an error of law. That's the final stop in the quality control at the state level, is these two higher courts. And I meant to mention earlier, when I was showing this schematic, the one opinion, the one type of case the Third Court of Appeals does not do is death penalty. That bypasses us and goes directly to the highest court of criminal appeals. And there's debate about whether those two should be consolidated, all that. It's kind of nice to know that death penalty cases go up and are specialized. They bypass us. We do everything else, life in prison, any other kind of criminal, but not death penalty. Back to that schematic. But that's it, and that's a tension in being able to write these in a way to reach all of cases.
I'm going to try to ask this in a way. We got a hand. Oh, got a couple hands. Yes, ma'am. Come on.
Wow, they just can't see me.
Howdy. I was going to ask, from a female point of view, and I teach at ASU. I'm not a law professor or anything like that, but I do teach law and ethics to educators. So students that are preparing to be a teacher or a guidance counselor, or even going into higher education administration with student and development, leadership, those kinds of roles. My thought as a woman, and my question to you, really goes towards relational aggression and what you see at these higher levels, because our students tend to shy away from learning about those things. And in one of our courses, the legal and ethics course, that's one of our topics that our women want to hear about, and they want to know how you at this level handle it versus us that are way down here. And I just asked to all three of you, what are some of the things that you've combated throughout your careers, or things that you still deal with that maybe I could relate to my students and help them in their path to go on to law school or to do something bigger and better in administration?
So y'all never met any resistance in your legal careers, right? Everyone was thoroughly welcoming. You never got called darling, right?
No, of course not. No, I do think that, you know, there are so many studies and so much literature out there about the differences in how men and women work together. From my own experience on the Texas Supreme Court, it's a very collegial court. If, you know, you don't have that tension and that aggression that's gender-based. Now, there are discussions on these, you know, very indeterminate cases that do take on more assertive tones, and I think it would be disingenuous for me to say that as a woman, I don't feel the pressure to be very cool all of the time. Otherwise, men make assumptions about our behavior. And so I think that is true, but I think that we possess that power as women to take that dialogue where we want to take it. And when we're around that table, you know, there is no gender. But I think that young women do face this more so than someone in my position. And I also think the legal profession has changed. When I began practicing, you know, in 1989, I was telling someone, I walked in a courtroom and the judge says, well, don't you little ladies get prettier and prettier every day? This is in the courtroom in front of my client. You wouldn't hear this anymore.
I heard the exact same, no.
you don't hear that anymore. So societal forces have brought change to the legal profession. So, but I think for your students, they really need to be in command of the way that they participate in the discussion. You can't control what the men might do. Some men, I work in a great environment, but you have to be in command, and it is a different role for women, in my experience.
Before we get the next comment, y'all may not know this. I worked 15 years for the city attorney of San Angelo, who was one of the brightest and most capable attorneys I've ever met in my life. And y'all may not know, her name is Mindy Ward. She's retired since then, but I was the guy. I worked with Karen for a while, but I was always the guy in the office. And let me tell you, they do think differently, but assertion is not something lacking in the new generation of female lawyers. But I'll tell you, Mindy's old school, Karen's younger, and we have many a story we could tell you. Karen's barely out of law school. So.
Sandra Day O'Connor said, I don't have, my influence on the court is not driven by my gender, it's by the opinions that I give. Yep. And, or something to that effect. And I think that that's very true. Thankfully, when I started in law, there were still some people who would talk about, you know, do you have to wear a skirt as opposed to could you wear pants, you know, and things like that. That's not the case anymore. That isn't the case anymore, but I am very aware that I am standing on the shoulders of people like Judge Clack. And so I'm aware of that, and I think that we've made great strides. And I think institutionally the courts, lend themselves to neutrality. So I'm not seeing it as much, but I'm aware that it's there.
And I would echo that. We have a very collegial court, and I, in private practice in 20 years doing business law, most of my clients and opposing counsel were men. And you get a stray comment. You also get a stray comment if you're young. Older lawyers try to browbeat you a little bit. And I would just always say, I like you despite what other people say about you. it just applies to everything. But I have a unique perspective a little bit that there's almost a tipping point, because most of my trials as a young female lawyer, you know, I'm 30 years old and my opposition might be a 50-year-old guy in a great-looking expensive suit, a business case. And the jury would look to me for veracity, because there's this bias out there. You read any jury study or any body language study, we're in business at least, We're trained to think that our sisters and our moms and our daughters wouldn't lie, but a guy might if push came to shove over money. So I kind of got an artificial bump. I think that, you know, and I don't think either of those stereotypes are right, but I tell you, there's a benefit to being a female judge. I think there's a public perception that women are fair and we're good at dealing with conflict. I've been happy to say I've had a great career, and that's just continuing that collegiality, and it's not about gender, it's about your facts and your work ethic. But I am going to get some gender aggression if I don't relay one message to y'all that my male colleagues on the court said. First of all, Jeff Rose, Scott Field, Purrier, Pemberton, they all said to tell y'all hello. But to point this out, in 18, because I was appointed to fill Jeff Rose's four-year vacancy, I have to run again in 18 for the full six-year term. And I didn't get an opponent this time around, primary or general. And I was teasing, I think it was Pemberton, I said, he's telling me, you don't know what it's like to not have a primary and a general opponent. Like my parents, they had to walk uphill both ways in the snow. And I said, hey, don't hate me, because I have never done anything political like this. It's a lot to learn. But they wanted me to remind you that two-thirds of our court will be up for election in 18. And Melissa and I didn't get opponents this time around, and I think it's just because Travis County has stopped nipping at our heels a little bit because we've done so well in this third court. But I think in 18 they will, and especially it's four of us up. And, you know, it's this county that pushes us over the edge. I mean, it really is. You know, of those 24 counties, right, there's one blue, the rest are red. But the blue is so many numbers. So we have to carry at least 40% of Travis County to even have a prayer. And this is before you even get into this issue of do people understand what we do, how important it is, whether we're good lawyers, good judges, that kind of thing. That's just on the numbers. So I wanted to relay that and say thank you, because that keeping, whether it's male or female, keeping good conservative judges on this court comes out of our other counties, especially ones like this that have such high, like 75% turnout. So thank you for that. And I'll tell the guys, those little guys, those handsome guys back home, that y'all said hello.
Can I add to that though? In that regard, women in the Third Court of Appeals district get a 4% bump over the guys.
Yeah.
And trust me, Scott and I had that conversation the next time around. Yes. He showed up.
Let me tell you, and God says it's not fair, by the way.
And I can't imagine, which is so funny, I cannot imagine the Third Court of Appeals without him. He is such a, I couldn't do it. I rely on him daily. But yeah, it's a 4% bump. So, you know, if they're worried about it, tell them to go into law, because it works out well for us.
Well, and I will say, I think all of these are great points. I will also point out that Republicans are merit-based generally. The life, it's about being, so when you talk to Republicans in the law, especially, you're going to see, I think, I really don't care whether you wear a skirt or not. I really care about whether you know what you're talking about. Now, having said that, having been the new guy in Mindy Ward City Attorney's Office for 15 years, aggression is asserted in different ways. And there is such a thing as a passive aggressive and definitely a direct aggression. But I'll tell you, my boss was brilliant at handling it. And I came to the city of San Angelo in 95. And it's a long time ago, Tracy, shush. But the point is, I came to the law practice and I thought I was a new man and a young man, and I was considered a misogynist in the office, and I took trouble and I had to learn. And I still struggle, we all do, with those things. But I'll tell you, those attorneys that were raised in those days, they learned to handle aggression by being competent, by knowing what they were talking about, and remembering that the point is to win, not the case, but win the point, to be respected in the profession, to know what you're talking about. And nobody ever, ever took on Mindy Warlett, because she knew what she was doing, and she was right. And I'll tell you, being right defeats all kinds of other types of aggression. And that's my personal opinion from observing one of the best lawyers, not female, just one of the best lawyers that I've ever been around. And I can tell you that nobody takes leave of their senses lightly in front of Judge Walther. Those of you that haven't ever practiced in front of Judge Walther know better than to misbehave. And I'll tell you, in my early days, yes, I saw it regularly. But I went to school in my class at Texas Tech was 94. We have St. Mary's. Who's St. Mary's? St. Mary's? We have Houston, right? No. Somebody had to go to University of Texas. Who was it that went to University of Texas? I'm sorry. Yeah. There wasn't a better school available, huh? I'm so sorry. So we've got a bunch of different universities. When I went in 94 and graduated, 52% of the class was female. We were outnumbered in our own class, and you know what? It was a good thing. Some of my best friends that are still practicing are out there, and a lot of them litigation. So, segue. How many of you did litigation? You were a trial attorney. You were a litigator.
I did trial and appellate.
Do you find that female attorneys become litigators at a higher level? I never noticed it before one way or the other, but most of the judges have experience in litigation. Is that something you've seen?
So ask me that again. Do the litigation trial attorney, do the litigators become judges more often?
Right.
I'm not sure about that. It certainly is an advantage to know trial and appellate procedure when you're now looking at it from this perspective. You get these cases that they file. The lawyers file these things called briefs. I'm not sure why they're called that. They're not brief. They are like 50 pages of spin and law and all this stuff. If you have that background, you can sort through it. And that helped me, not having been a judge. I could rely on those skills. But, you know, it'd be hard, for example, if you were, maybe a transactional attorney doing business deals and had never been in a court, to then get these big box of problems that we have and try to sort it out, understand what happened, and then see if the law was applied correctly.
So you think it's a gender issue, or is it a type of law that you practice? I mean, why are we suddenly getting all these wonderful female judges in Texas? Is it because we weren't so good with female lawyers in the past?
Yes, TFRW.
It's all TFRW. Well, congratulations, TFRW. I'll take that one. So, anything else?
I want to mention this. I do have a Democratic opponent in November. I have a website, ebaguzman.com, and I hope that you will get your friends to vote. When I did my polling in the primary, I was 12 points down, and you heard how we ended up, but it's important that everybody gets out to vote, and so I hope that you'll send emails. Texas's every major office is, we have one Democrat at the Court of Criminal Appeals who used to be a Republican, maybe. But anyway, it's important to us, and thank you so much.
I'm going to brag on my folks for a second, Justice Guzman, and I think they'll back me up. One thing I haven't had any trouble since I, as a lawyer around here, is explaining the concept of the Third Court of Appeals and its linchpin. And I don't think it's a stretch to say that the Supreme Court is as important. Sorry, Justice Borland, maybe even a little more important. But we certainly understand that. And for those of you that have any questions about that, please throw up your hand. But we have had no trouble getting these folks to come out and support our candidates for Third Court of Appeals. A teacher had her phone on. Yes! I'm going to tell my son. They've done very well, I think. I had the joy of calling them during the last election and telling, and I will tell a secret. There was a justice on your court that when I called him and said, because I had to count first, I was up at the central count, and I said, we already got your 15,000 you need. He giggled like a schoolgirl. So you tell him, gender aggression, my tushy. No, it was a wonderful feeling to be able to call those judges and say, we got you your votes. We got you your votes, and we'll do that for you again, I promise you. Now, get out there and win the rest of the state, because this is your home. We've got you here, okay? But anybody else have any questions?
Well, I had a question, but that's fine, because we're getting on into the evening. If y'all would stay there, because I saw all these people taking pictures, if y'all could stay there for just a moment.
We would love. So if I could get you to, ladies and gentlemen, thank the kind justices for their service.